Good afternoon. It's irony that I have to talk after you, Chief. I have been at the receiving end of sir trying to make me set up a vertigo lab, and believe me, you don't want to be in that place. So my topic is rehabilitation in unilateral vestibular failure. This morning, Dr. Bhatt spoke about bilateral vestibular failure rehabilitation. So a lot of overlap is going to happen here. I'll just skip over those sections when I come. The first thing I would like to say is rehabilitation or vestibular rehabilitation therapy is much beyond what we used to know. When we think about VRT, we think Cawthon-Cooksey, we think Branderoff. It's much beyond that now. It's been proven that VRT is a valuable approach to rehabilitate the patient and reduce the symptoms. The review of literature is very strong. There was a Cochrane study conducted in 2011, which I'm going to come to, which shows why exactly we have to do VRT. Previously, there are some terminologies which have changed over the years. Previously, what we called adaptation and substitution is now together grouped as gaze stabilization exercises. And when do you do? Unilateral vestibular loss means you have a stable lesion to deal with. To have a stable lesion, you have to first give the definitive treatment that is required for the patient, whether it's BPPV, Meniere's, vestibular nerve section, or vestibular neuronitis. Sorry. The goals are simple. You need a vertiginous patient who has come to you with acute giddiness to settle down, and finally, go about his normal work as he used to before he started these symptoms. So you have to decrease his symptoms. You have to make sure there is functional balance. Now this term is key. What is functional balance is different professions will have different requirements of functional balance. You don't expect, generally we have patients who are drivers, who are painters, they have different positions in which they induce vertigo for them. So you have to take in consideration that particular patient's particular symptom. So strategies based on individualized VRT are in now. You have to improve their ability to see during head movements. So basically you need the patient to go back into society as a normal person. So what aspects are getting rehabilitated? When you talk about vestibular rehabilitation, there are two concepts here. One is static, another is dynamic. Static means that I'm standing right here doing nothing, but I still have a postural instability. I'm falling to one side. This is static. Or if I'm sitting and typing on something, my head is not moving, but I have nystagmus and skew deviation. Now the concept behind this is the vestibulo-ocular reflex for the skew deviation, and for the vestibulospinal reflex is aberrant. Dynamic vestibular system gets challenged when the patient walks. You're walking and looking up, looking on either sides. This is challenging the patient's system. This also needs to be rehabilitated, and they are two different things. So there was this study done on humans also, but this is a baboon study. If you see, the concept of the study was that you have to make sure that the patient gets up and starts doing his normal day-to-day activities as soon as possible, because if that doesn't happen, then rehabilitation will take time. This was a study in which you can see the interrupted lines here. The baboon was restricted after a vestibular nerve section, and the rehabilitation took a long time. The approach to vertigo has to be threefold: gaze stabilization, habituation, and postural stabilization. These three together constitute VRT. Gaze stabilization, Dr. Bhatt spoke about in the morning. He had very nice videos regarding this. There are three ways of doing gaze stabilization. First, you have a fixed target and you move your head looking at the target. Second, you have two targets, and first you move your head, move only the eyes, and then you can move the targets in opposite direction of your eye. Now, this all the time you have to maintain fixity on the target. This is the second type. Third type is what we call remembered target. Now, in the first two, what is happening is probably central compensation and pre-learned behavior is acting. Whereas in remembered target exercise, what is done is a target is kept in front. You look at it, close your eyes, the patient shakes his head and then opens, fixing on the target. For this, you require cervical inputs and probably central inputs. Habituation is a exercise which we have all come to know very well, that's Cawthorn-Cooksey. Habituation basically means you give a stimulus so often that it stops being irritating to the patient. So if a patient has a problem in lying down on the right side, you make him lie down on the right side. Do it systematically. Do it again and again. Do it at intervals and make sure that the patient doesn't have that symptom. So Cawthorn and Cooksey in 1940s were treating patients with post-cerebral concussion, vertigo, and they developed these sets of exercises. These are something which we normally know. These are given handouts in OPD. But what we don't understand about this is when you send a patient home with this handout, that's not motivation enough to do the exercise. If you tell the patient, okay, do these, just tick, 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 and then say, okay, go on, do this, it's not going to happen. These patients will come back to you with symptoms and say nothing has improved because you do not sit with them and do not tell them that you have to do this for how long and for how many days. Remember, you have to tell them to keep at it for at least 6 weeks for it to show good results and for the results to be sustainable. Cawthorn-Cooksey, we know. Now this is something new. This is called motion sensitivity quotient. Motion sensitivity quotient. It has 16 positions the patient is put in. Now the problem with Cawthorn-Cooksey is they are general exercises which are made for everybody. Now if the patient has a particular problem, you can't give a one size fits all kind of Cawthorn-Cooksey exercise to them. So you have to do these positions. That's what they are suggesting now. There are different positions here, including Dix Hall Pike, sitting and suddenly lying on the right, suddenly lying on the left. Now this is probably the future. I'm saying probably because we're not sure yet. We don't know how it compares to Cawthorn-Cooksey, but this makes sense. Why? Because in this there are parameters in which the patient will tell you how intense it is on a score of 5. You will note the duration of the giddiness, you will score it, and the top 4 symptoms. Say that the patient is having problems in getting up from lying down on the right side. Now these 4 are only used for rehabilitation. You don't give a Cawthorn-Cooksey for everybody. You just give these top 4 exercises, give it for a month to 6 weeks, and when the patient comes back, you increase the intensity. Next aspect is postural stabilizing exercises. This also was dealt with in the morning. Now the concept here is to stress the system. You do not make the patient comfortable. So you have, initially you can see this lady standing on regular floor, then with closed eyes, then on foam, that with closed eyes, and this man doing this particular exercise with a foot ruler on the side, bending to one side. Now, it's important that the patient does this to the best possible ability. The concept here is when you remove a stimulus, say that I'm standing on this surface and my proprioception is good because it's a hard surface. If I stand on foam, the sensory stimulus from my proprioceptors is gone. That forces the system to utilize other systems to make the balance okay. So that will help rehabilitation. And the central mechanism for rehabilitation is at the molecular level, there are receptor changes happening. For it to occur, you have to stress the system. For that, you have to remove sensory stimuli, give sensory stimuli, and make the patient do these exercises in different levels of darkness. General considerations are, first, start early. Start early doesn't mean that if the patient presents to you late, you don't start. It's been proven that no matter when the patient comes to you, a week or a year later, if you start VRT, it will always work. But if you start early, the patient can be rehabilitated back early. Head movement should be encouraged because these patients typically keep their neck very stiff. You have to set an individual goal to a patient. You can't say that everybody has to start playing tennis or golf. You have to make sure what you want that patient to achieve at the end of your VRT. Stress the system, gradually increase the speed. This is something which we are not doing. vertigo patient walking into the clinic gives you a sensation of, oh my goodness, because it takes about half an hour to explain to a patient what to do. But if you do this, and if you tell the patient that you have to increase the intensity, this is not enough. You have to do it fast, then slow, then fast, then slow, alternate. These things have to be explained to the patient, work at the top limit of the patient's ability, and by decreasing base of support. What does that mean? That means that if I am doing my eye exercises standing like this, first in a comfortable position, then you get the legs together, then you do it in rhombus, then you do it in modified rhombus. Do all this, narrow the base of support so that the system is stressed adequately. It can take up to 6 weeks. Now the tricks in doing a VRT are not saying that do these exercises. What you need to understand is you have to increase and alternate the speed. Do it during various positions and activities. You can do the same movement while sitting, standing, walking. Decrease the visual or somatosensory input. That means you keep a foam, switch off the lights, do it in a dark environment, and do it while doing, basically don't allow the patient to get comfortable. So can you, the patient can just add 5-5-5 or 4-4-4, some mental mathematics can be given, and in different environments. The main problems that we come across when we have a patient coming in is, first is visual blurring. Visual blurring means that when the patient is turning the head, there is blurring. So in this, you have to start a slow VOR rehabilitation exercise. Now, why start slow? If a patient is coming to you acutely, why don't you go aggressive and say, no, I'm going to do this fast? Because VOR gain will start very slowly, 0.25 to 0.5 per week. So for that to occur, you have to start slow. Second problem is exacerbation. Exacerbation requires habituation to be substituted. That means the patient is overdoing it. You want the patient to slow down and habituate, and then can increase the intensity. Postural instability and problems with balance and gait can be dealt with by getting the patient into a particular environment where, like if the patient has a problem walking home at night in a supermarket, we can give particular exercises for that. I'll come to it. Deconditioning. This happens when a patient is in bed after a neurosurgery for a long time and not able to get up. So deconditioning has happened. Even this, you have to ask the patient to first walk around in the ward maybe for 10 minutes, 20 minutes, and then gradually increase. The biggest problem that we come across is driving. Generally, some people are drivers, some want to begin driving again. That's their question. How do you answer? Their life depends on this. If the patient gets a vertigo during driving, you are responsible for the accidents it can cause if you have given fitness. So the rule of thumb, I don't know how others would do it, but make sure that dynamic visual acuity is okay. If the patient passes this, then you can safely assume he's okay for driving. And after that, you can increase the risk of driving slowly. Like first start in familiar neighborhoods and then move on to unfamiliar. Now, this is a ideal setup for VRT. If you see, there are various things here. One is a carpeted surface. There is a pillow, chair, obstacle course, somebody trying to do activities with the patient, and this is what we need. Now the landmark Cochrane review, which I'm talking about, is this. This gave us the evidence that we can't just prescribe vestibular suppressants to all patients. That doesn't work. So they conducted a study in 2007 with 21 studies included, and they added six more in 2011. This was a meta-analysis, and they compared. What did these studies do? They took VRT and compared it to sham exercises. They took VRT and compared it to medication, and they came up with these conclusions very briefly. Vestibular suppressant will not improve the patient eventually. You have to give a VRT. Not enough to just provide a handout. You have to go into details and tell the patient exactly what you have to do. Customize the VRT to the patient. The vertigo sensitivity quotient can be used. VRT versus placebo versus neutral exercise and no exercise, VRT came up trumps. VRT versus computerized posturography, now this is difficult to do. Computerized posturography along with Cawthon-Cooksey at home, this had a better result, but this is difficult to achieve. And VRT, different VRTs like gaze stabilization versus spinal exercises, everything worked. So basically, bottom line is start VRT as soon as possible. Why did some recur? You have patients who are recurring. So they decided that they'll find out in the same study, 12 to 15% of recurrences were noted. They looked at age and gender. Is that causing it? No, because age, generally an older person will have a slower gait, they'll walk slower, but that doesn't mean that they can't recover completely from this. Time from onset did not make a difference, vestibular deficit did not. What made a difference was giving vestibular suppressants. Now when you do that, VRT cannot act effectively because it requires the vestibular system to be stressed to be able to slowly start rehabilitations for the central compensation to occur. So this was the bottom line. Now I'm calling this the emergence of the avatar age because that was the movie that actually got virtual reality and 3D into the mainstream. Now what is happening is almost 90% of the world's population, this is a study that they have access to high speed, good bandwidth internet and mobile networks. Effectively, they have apps that can be downloaded and everything is in the mobile phone now. And mobile phones are not simple devices. They have gyroscopes, GPS, they have accelerometers. So these are the future. So what exactly will happen in future for VRT? It's not just Cawthon Cooksey. See where it goes from here. There are two kinds of systems for doing a VRT with gadgets. One is a high-end system. These are all high-end systems. So first they started with a head-mounted system in which a goggle is worn by the patient. Now the problem with this is the patient develops something called simulator sickness or cyber sickness. Why? Because the goggle is completely covering the patient's eye this way and there is no lateral view at all. So the patient will not cooperate after a while because they develop the sickness. This is a balance rehab unit in which a foam platform has been added to this. Now both of these are similar kind of devices. Now this revolutionized this. Initially in Chicago, they developed something called the CAVE system. This is a BNAV, the balance near automatic virtual environment. What is happening here is the patient is not wearing any goggles. If you can see, there is a grocery cart being pushed here, and this is a treadmill. This grocery cart is actually a joystick. Now, these screens, it's a small room with screens on three sides and a projector behind projecting the entire scene on the screens, and the patient walks with this grocery cart. So this is a wide field of vision kind of setup. Now all these, the problem is they need a setup. They are in a very R&D stage. This Dr. Shitaj I was talking to in the morning, he has this, he uses this. I don't have experience with this, but this is a good idea. These are nothing but gaming consoles which have been released. This is Nintendo Wi-Fit Plus. If you see, this force platform here has four pressure sensors, and this is so remarkable that it can compare to a lab-made force platform. So these are gaming consoles which are coming up with such advanced technology, and this one is made by the Sony Xbox. It's called Kinect. So these technologies are coming up. So the future. The question here is not if it is the next big thing. I think it is the biggest thing because this means that you will have VRT on your mobile. And it's as simple as that. I think a video is missing. Yes, I wanted to show you all this video. Now this is a very morphed look of the video. This is how a VRT will look inside. Interestingly, when I took this off the internet on my phone, how it worked was I was seeing a grocery aisle and I could turn and I can see the various items. I can look up at the light, look down. But when it's playing on the computer, which doesn't have a sensor, which doesn't have a motion sensor, GPS, gyroscope, this is how it looks. And this is the, yes, this is the infrared camera and the wide field rehabilitation happening. Patient is very safely kept in a harness. Now that is about VRT. It's still in virtual reality. It is in R&D stage. Now there's some technology for augmented sensory feedback. What is happening in this is the patient has vertigo and is not able to maintain balance. So there are other systems which are being used to give the patient an idea that, okay, my balance is not good right now. So what are those systems? The tongue, taste, you can give audio inputs. So how cumbersome they are, this is how it looks. So you can imagine a patient strapped to sensors and has a sensor on the tongue which gives you an indication that, okay, I'm losing balance and there's some sensation, electrical stimulation over the tongue. Not very practical. This is the audio stimulation happening. Vestibular electrical stimulus basically means the nuchal electrodes over the neck, the electrodes are placed, and probably because of the stimulation there, it's giving you a small indication that the balance is going off. Now these are not practical. You cannot really walk in a harness strapped to devices. But what is practical is this, and it looks amazing. Vibrotactile feedback. This is basically an app on your phone. Currently it's a device, but in the future it will be an app on your phone. The phone has gyroscopes, the phone has technology on it. You just keep it in your pocket and there'll be a small vibration when you lose your balance, and that could be a fantastic development for VRT, especially for practical rehabilitation of patients. So to summarize, I would like to say that unilateral vestibular loss is not a lost situation. It will definitely rehabilitate to almost normal. You can return to most, you expect the patient to return to most of his activities. There is evidence in human beings that exercise will facilitate recovery. So please do not blindly prescribe vestibular suppressants. That's a request. Early intervention may not be important, but it will help to rehabilitate the patient back into the environment as soon as possible. Virtual reality is still in R&D mode, but looks very, very promising. And the last biofeedback devices, they could be low cost, portable in the pocket itself. So this is the future, virtual reality. Probably in 5 years from now, maybe when technology develops so fast, we'll come to those apps that can be downloaded. Already on iPhone, there's an app called Visual Vertical. You take the iPhone, stick it into a bucket, and you can actually do the Visual Vertical on the iPhone. So that is the strength of technology currently. We can't ignore it. Thank you for your patience.
Thank you very much, Dr. Shenoy. I like your presentation a lot. It's very informative and evidence-based. And thanks for highlighting the importance. Balance is not only dependent on the individual and his physiology and the integrity of anatomy. Balance is also dependent on the task and the environment. So in rehabilitation concept, as Dr. Shenoy highlighted, we have to change our philosophy of VRT. So it's not only about the individual. Cowthorn, Cox exercise not enough because they do work only on the individual. But you have to build VRT programs based on the individual and the task, like multitasking, mental or other cognitive tasks during and the different environments. Thank you.